Full Story Quest Audiobooks presents Augmented by Anthony James, narrated by Edward Mitchell. The Graveyard. The sixth planet in the Hyle system was alight, its cold, rocky surface hidden beneath a conflagration of intense whites, oranges, and reds. High above this doomed world, the human and Estral fleets exchanged missile and particle beam fire. Incendiaries blossomed across a million kilometers of space, their detonations enough to destroy a number of the smaller ships outright and deplete the energy shields of the larger ones. The Hadron battleship, Precept 2, launched wave upon wave of sublight missiles, and its tactical computer kept track of 100,000 others already in flight. Gauss slugs from the Estral Vuel cannons and the human bulwarks streaked through space, thinning the salvos of inbound missiles. The Precept 2's battle computer recorded the impacts of its third wave of Lambda missiles against one of the Estral capital ships. The enemy craft was lost for a moment in a wave of thunderous explosions, and then it burst free from the inferno, its energy shield trailing plasma fire 1,000 kilometers behind. The battle continued for what seemed like an age, with each side unable to land the killing blow. In space combat, no stalemate could last forever. A group of galactic-class heavy cruisers broke away from the main human fleet and attempted to smash through a cluster of Estral vessels which acted as a soak for the enemy battleships. For a moment, it looked as if the daring attack would be successful. Then the Precept 2 detected the deployment of an obsidia bomb. The battleship was too far away to be caught in the midst of the blast, but the heavy cruisers and the sixth planet were not. The galactics vanished from the tactical screen and 50% of the planet disintegrated, leaving its molten core visible like a beacon. Precept 2. War protocol breached. Deploy enlightenment. The Hadron sensors recorded the retaliatory deployment of a second obsidia bomb, and this detonation was far larger than the first. Many Estral spaceships were completely obliterated, their energy shields incapable of withstanding the force of the explosion. The battle continued. The soft bleeping of an alarm roused Lieutenant Becky Keller, and she cut off her interface with the Precept 2. Returning her consciousness to the cockpit of the shuttle which hovered high above the graveyard on planet Ariel. "You are not permitted to interface with these ships, Lieutenant," the shuttle's AI node, XR, chided her. "You won't tell, will you?" she asked teasingly, not caring one way or another.
"If I had lips, they would be sealed, ma'am."
Keller lifted one arm and pointed a finger at the sensor screen. The feed was aimed directly at the leftmost of the Hadrons. The battleship was a hulking wedge shape, broad and menacing. Its 6,000-meter hull was extensively cratered and burned, with hardly any of its armor plating intact. "It's lost none of its pride. XR, when was the Precept 2 decommissioned?"
"The Precept 2 was decommissioned 118 years ago, ma'am. It was one of the final Hadrons to leave service. Its duty lasted to the end of the Third Estral War before it was classified as obsolete."
"Shame. It feels like a betrayal to abandon all these ships, to leave them here like we never needed them." There were hundreds of open receptors in the graveyard, and Keller reached out again to the Precept 2's ancient processing cluster. The battleship's cores were painfully slow and incapable of preventing her gentle interrogation of its databanks. There was a yearning there, like an entity denied full access to the consciousness it was capable of. Keller pulled away, trying to convince herself she only imagined the spaceship's disappointment at her withdrawal. Keller had seen enough. Darkness was creeping across the horizon, and she suddenly wanted to be away from this place.
"Priority 1 message from Admiral Cody," said XR.
"What is the message?"
"You will return to the base immediately. Please acknowledge."
"Of course I damn well acknowledge. What does he want?"
"I have no further information for you, ma'am."
"Can't he speak with me here?"
"I have no further information for you, ma'am."
Keller used her Fower augmentation to link with the transport's flight computer and ordered it to fly to the Fortress 3 base at top speed. The journey didn't take long, but Keller had ample time to interrogate the Space Corps databanks, where she discovered something entirely unexpected.
"Well, well," she said under her breath. "There is a name I haven't heard in a long time."
With a feeling of nervousness and anticipation, Lieutenant Becky Keller brought the shuttle in to land.
1.
Admiral Scott Cody was a broad man of advancing years and with the same short cropped grey hair worn by seemingly every male admiral in the Space Corps, as well as some of the females. Cody paced the length of his office, making no effort to disguise his agitation. He stopped exactly two paces before one blue-painted wall, spun, walked and repeated the process at the opposite wall. Every so often, he cursed under his breath. Admiral Cody was not renowned for his patience, and today he looked properly pissed off. Lieutenant Covops Joe Nation shifted, unable to get comfortable in a chair which probably cost 10,000 Fed bucks. The room smelled of coffee and leather, and he could hear a high-pitched background squeal of electronics. Nation flexed his right arm and felt the faintest sensation of movement from the Estolia motors which powered his body. There were some parts of him which were almost original, but he was damned if he could remember where in his body they were. He'd given up his flesh and here he was, a pile of augmentations clad in artificial skin. With his consciousness fed into a data array designed to withstand a direct hit from an Estral sledgehammer. He suppressed a shiver. Estolia leaked cold and he could never seem to get warm since the surgeons finished with him. Another 5 uneasy minutes passed before Nation heard the office door hiss open. He turned in his seat to see a very familiar woman enter. She was in her late 20s with a slim, athletic build, dark hair tied up and the most piercing green eyes. She wore a tight-fitting black cloth uniform without adornment.
"Lieutenant Becky Keller," said Cody with a nod. His voice was deep, like he'd taken lessons in how to project it. "Take a seat."
Keller sat.
"This is Lieutenant Joe Nation," Cody went on. "He's another one from the labs. Covert ops."
Nation nodded acknowledgement.
"We've met before, sir."
"Once or twice," said Keller dryly.
"Well, that's good," said Cody. "It means we don't have to waste time on how-do-you-dos."
He began another trip towards the wall, thought better of it, and sat opposite the two of them. His desk was clear apart from a communicator and a couple of screens. Without moving his eyes, Cody leaned forward and switched the communicator to silent.
"Folks, there's some shit going on," he said.
Nation knew when it was time to stay quiet, and Keller had the same instinct. They waited.
"We've got ourselves a problem over an ITOB too."
Nation scratched his head and took the bait.
"That's an Estral facility, sir." "Quite right, Lieutenant. It's one of their 6 obsidian Turonium refinement bases. You know the ones. Where they perform civilian research."
He drummed his thick fingers on the desktop.
"There's been an incident."
"What kind of incident?" asked Keller.
"It's one of those everyone's dead kind of incidents. Under the terms of our treaty, we sent out a team 2 days ago. Their attempts to find out what happened aren't going to plan."
Humans and Estral had been involved in on-off wars for decades, and it was only recently the Confederation had gained enough of an upper hand to begin dictating conditions at the end of what was a long, drawn-out conflict. One of those conditions imposed strict controls on the Estral's ability to refine obsidian Turonium into its much more potent form, Estolia, and, more specifically, to put it to military uses.
2 days is plenty of time for a preliminary evaluation. What's the holdup?" asked Keller.
"The Estral don't want us there." Cody's face twisted angrily. "They're cleaning up the evidence even while our team tries to find out what's going on."
"They signed an agreement to limit their refinement to just stabilized obsidian Turonium. Why don't we clear the facility of Estral and get on with the job?" said Nation.
"ISOB 2 is deep inside Estral territory, Lieutenant. It's all very well talking about imposing our wishes. It's another thing entirely when it comes to doing so. I think if we'd given our friends another few hours to get their act together, they'd have turned away our investigation team.
And risk another war.
You know what they're like. Proud bastards. Like every other race is a piece of crap stuck to the sole of their shoes. The Confederation Council have made their wishes clear. This isn't worth a resumption of hostilities."
"The Estral take everything to the edge, sir. Every time we blink first, they become bolder."
Cody sighed.
"You're not telling me anything new, Lieutenant Nation. If it were my choice, I'd turn up at ISOB 2 with 50 warships and see what these alien bastards have to say about it. We can't piss around when it comes to Estolia. It's the only thing keeping us ahead."
"Which is why they crave it so much," said Keller.
"We can't trust them with it. We know what the results will be."
The Estral were ruthless when they had an advantage. There was no way the Confederation was going to slacken the rules on the refinement of obsidian uranium. Humanity had teetered on the brink of extinction on more than one occasion, and now the determination to survive was ingrained. Whatever it took.
"What information do we have about ISOB 2, sir?" asked Nation. "Surely our team found something."
"The Estral are playing their cards close to their chests. Our monitoring hardware picked up traces of certain contaminants within the facility. Granol 42, for instance."
"You said no survivors."
"I said that to get your attention. We have no real evidence to say every Estral was killed. We're relying on a degree of assumption."
Cody's expression told exactly what he thought about assumption.
"What killed them?"
"The Estral won't say, or they don't know. We don't know either."
"Have we been given access to the bodies?"
"That's one of the main sticking points at the moment. They've locked the base down and the lower levels are off limits, ostensibly to allow the level of contaminants to subside."
"Smells fishy."
"You don't say."
There was an elephant in the room, and Nation felt obliged to mention it.
"They're up to something at ISOB 2 which breaks the treaty."
"More than likely."
"And they're shit scared we'll find the proof."
"I see all that training hasn't gone to waste, Lieutenant Nation."
Nation used his comm augmentation to tap into the Space Corps records, and dozens of files streamed into his databanks. It took him a few nanoseconds to pick out the salient details.
"We've been covertly monitoring ISOB 2 for months."
"They've brought in several disguised shipments recently. In shielded containers, or mixed up with other materials which can produce false positives on our sensors."
"What's the best guess from the strategy guys?"
"Obsidian teronium refinement gone wrong."
Nation watched Keller from the corner of his eye.
"If it's so cut and dried, what do you need us for?" he asked.
"Proof. We can't act without it."
"And if we find proof?" asked Keller. "Is this the beginning of a new war?"
Cody didn't look entirely pleased with the question.
"Quite the opposite. We see it as a method of stopping a war."
"What happens next?"
"You're going to join our existing team, except you aren't going to be playing it by the book. You're two of the Space Corps' most accomplished officers, and you know how to get results."
"I take it we'll be catching a spaceship to ISOB 2 and having a poke around the facility?"
"That's about it. The evidence we have suggests this is the tip of an iceberg that could be big enough to cause some real crap in our immediate future if we run into it."
"Or if it runs into us."
"A turn of phrase, Lieutenant Keller," said Cody testily.
"Does this mean we have clearance to take risks?"
"You know the answer to that."
Nation almost laughed.
"Find out everything there is to be found out and don't get caught. One day I might get a mission with a different brief."
"Who else is on our team?" asked Keller.
"We've got some men and women already out there. Rapid response team Alpha from the SC Givens."
"So when we pitch up uninvited, what exactly are we going to tell the Estral?"
"The story is you're part of the RRT Alpha. That makes you military scientists."
"I'm no scientist," said Nation. "And Lieutenant Keller is in Psi. What are we supposed to do when they start asking technical questions?"
"Use those core clusters the Space Corps implanted in your heads at vast expense. That's what they're there for. Try and sound convincing."
Nation shrugged. As far as briefings went, this was neither the longest nor the shortest he'd ever sat through.
"I can do that." "I saw the SC Gunder on the landing strip," said Keller. Cody gave a half smile.
"We couldn't send you in a beat-up piece of crap. The Space Corps likes to look good when we're trying to strong-arm a mob of warlike aliens into letting us into one of their prize facilities."
"A Class 1 retaliator. I'm impressed," said Nation.
"One of 30 in the fleet, 400 meters from nose to tail."
Admiral Cody was far too young to have flown one of the older style warships, some of which exceeded 5,000 meters in length, but the curl of his lips suggested he longed for the days he'd never experienced.
"And we've had to remove some of its external armaments in case the Estral take offense."
Cody's lip curled even further.
"Damn, tiptoeing around like we're the bad guys."
Nation kept his expression neutral.
"Have we got clearance to fly, or are we putting in a surprise appearance?"
"The Estral are expecting to see you on the far side of the Primal 1 wormhole within 4 hours. The urgency saves you from spending the next 2 weeks with one of my briefing teams. The Estral aren't happy about it, so don't expect handshakes and party hats.
Cody stared for a long moment and then clapped his hands with a single loud crack.
Why are you still in my office? Get moving and bring me back some good news.
Keller and Nation exchanged glances. Whatever the outcome of this mission, it was unlikely to be anything which could be classified as good.
Yes, sir. Good news it is.
Nation stood easily and his chair creaked in relief. Keller remained seated.
One more thing. Who's in charge?
You're a team, Lieutenant Keller. I trust there'll be no issues.
No, sir. I was referring to the guys on RRT Alpha. Do they know who we are?
We've sent them an encrypted comms message telling them to give you whatever help you require.
Cody smiled grimly.
And to pretend they know who you are.
That's reassuring.
And remember, both of you, the Estral don't need to know about your augmentations, so don't do anything that gives the game away.
It was the same message Nation had heard before.
I don't need reminding. It's all I seem to hear since they finished stitching me together.
Keller stood.
This is damned important, isn't it?
More important than you know. Things are strained. Don't screw this one up.
The two of them left the room and Cody watched the automatic door shut behind them. With a stab of his finger, he took his desktop communicator out of silent mode and impassively waited for the inevitable rush. 2. The Fortress 3 base was a place of sweeping architectural achievement. It covered an area of 25 square kilometers and, while many of its structures were blocky and utilitarian, in places it possessed sweeping curves and unusual shapes designed to astound the eye. Most of the buildings were constructed from stone-clad alloy and painted white or green or blue. Wide, tree-lined streets played host to smart gravity cars, which danced gracefully through the traffic, whilst hundreds of shuttles sped through the air. A row of well-polished pool cars gleamed in front of the command and control building. The closest one was all straight lines, with clear windows and metallic white paint. It hovered a few inches from the ground, waiting obediently. Keller pulled the door open and sat on the faux leather front passenger bench, while Nation climbed in the other side.
The landing strip, Keller ordered. S.C. Gunder.
Certainly, ma'am, replied the car.
The onboard computer possessed an irritatingly cheerful voice which became grating after about 30 seconds of its inane patter. The vehicle pulled out into the slow-moving traffic and the two passengers watched the bustle of the Fortress 3 base without much interest.
It's been a long time, said Nation eventually.
Yup.
What did you think of that speech Cody gave us?
The same as you. He was worried, and if he's worried, that means every other admiral is feeling it too.
That's what I reckon. It was like someone had crapped in his favourite boots.
The gravity car hummed along one of the main thoroughfares, its navigational computer guiding it easily through the variety of other vehicles. Even during peacetime, the base was busy. Cars, lorries, and light crawlers crowded the wide roads, along with a trio of light tanks headed towards one of the shuttle pads.
This must be your first assignment in a while, said Nation.
Keller peered at him suspiciously, trying to decide if he was fishing for a reaction.
They tell me I'm too valuable to risk.
Not this time, though.
Evidently, someone believes they had no choice.
They don't want the Estral to clear up the site before we get there.
That's my take on it.
Our allies need to learn when to accept the hand of friendship.
Maybe they don't have it in them. We have a peace treaty. There is nothing in it which says humans and Estral need to be drinking buddies.
Nation gave a snort of laughter.
I guess peace is always better than war.
You don't sound like you believe it.
Of course I do. Are you getting any feel for what's happening?
Not yet. Perhaps I'll get a sense of the probabilities when we get there. It usually works better when I'm in proximity.
The infinite model, huh?
It's still a thing.
Keller tilted her head back and closed her eyes. Few people understood how the members of the Psi team did what they did, but Lieutenant Nation knew better than most. At the extremes of humanity's normal distribution curve existed individuals with the ability to predict the outcome of any event with a far greater degree of accuracy than chance alone dictated. For these people, the universe existed as a probability model in which every possible event might happen. Occasionally, such a person was offered a glimpse of the model, and therefore a hint of the future. Lieutenant Becky Keller had all that and much more. Nation studied her carefully.
They invested a lot in you when they decided to fit you with a Fowler augmentation.
She shrugged and tapped the side of her head with a finger. The Fowler implant constructs a simulation based on what I tell it. Sometimes it comes up with the goods, other times, nothing. And it makes you into one hell of a pilot. In an age where we bow down to the prowess of the battle computers, there's hardly anyone left who can outperform an AI. So they tell me. A great pilot. Not such a good killer, though. She spoke with her eyes still closed, and the hint of a smile played at one corner of her mouth. It doesn't sound like there'll be anything to kill on this mission. Since we'll be amongst friends. She opened her eyes. Nation was gone. You know I'm a covert op and not an assassin. His voice came from nowhere, but when Keller stuck out a hand, it connected with a solid object which she guessed was his arm. Turn off your stealth modules when you're talking to me. The air blurred for a split second, and then Nation was visible once more. It's going to be hard getting lost in the crowd when there are only two of us. 2 or 100, the Estral won't watch us any less carefully. It's like we're talking about the enemy. They may as well be. He looked at Keller sharply, wondering if she'd divined some probability of the future and wasn't letting on. There was no change in her face, at least nothing he could read. The gravity car continued its journey through the main warehouse district of the base. It was a muggy, grey day on Ariel, and the vehicle's air conditioning struggled to keep things cool. Nation turned one of the control knobs and it came off in his hand. He dropped it into the footwell in disgust. I thought you couldn't feel the heat, said Keller. I can't. Not really. He pinched a flap of skin on the back of his hand. I get signals telling me if it's hot or cold. What happens when it gets to 300 degrees outside? Unimportant stimuli get shut down so they're no longer a distraction. You can shut them down any time. I don't want to. There's not much left of Joe Nation, so I'll hold on tightly to what I can. Whatever they did to fix you up, you're still Joe Nation. You definitely look like Joe Nation. She prodded him in the arm. Feels like skin as well. I'm not complaining. It's better to be like this than dead. Way better. I think I prefer the old Joe Nation. Keller was gently teasing, something she was good at. So what have you been up to? This and that. Hush, hush. Let's find out. Nation linked in with the core network and checked through Keller's files to see what she'd been up to in the last few years. There weren't many personnel in the Psi team. So few people in the Confederation possessed the gift. Those the Space Corps managed to bring within the military fold were handled with exceptional care. The Psi team members were in the military, yet without being subject to the same discipline, and it allowed them to retain far more of their individuality than many other Corps personnel. It wasn't much different for those in covert ops, and rank wasn't always an accurate reflection of seniority. Without warning, Nation found himself ejected from the records. His Estolia processing cluster dragged a copy of the files into his databanks where, to his astonishment, they were force deleted. Has anyone ever told you it's rude to pry? Asked Keller. Don't you ever do that again, he said furiously. Do you hear me? I apologize, I was trying to make a point. Badly. I'm sorry. You can stop clenching your fists now. Don't do that again, he repeated. After a few deep breaths, he felt calm again. Keller was one of those people it was hard to stay mad at. How did you do that? The Fowler is like nothing you ever guessed. Can I block you? She didn't answer directly. That was the last time, I promise. Keller sat upright and peered through the glass windscreen. We're coming onto the landing strip. The Gundor is the third ship parked up. There it is, said Nation. It's a beauty. A weapon capable of incredible destruction. The SC Gundor was V-shaped, covered in silver-grey alloy plates, and it rested on several dozen thick standing legs. The front of the ship narrowed to a squared-off point, while the main body of the craft was a tapered cylinder which housed the Estolia power source. Two thick wings protruded 100 meters from each side. They weren't to provide lift. Instead, they housed the stasis emitters which could shut down enemy craft. The top rear section contained the housing for the particle beam repeater weapon, this being the spaceship's main armament. Compared to an old Hadron battleship from years gone by, the Gundor could generate 1,000 times the power from a fraction of the volume. Deadly like a scalpel, said Keller. From her eyes, Nation could tell Keller was lost in the memory of something and he didn't ask. The gravity car veered into a gap between a pile of metal crates and a maintenance crane, before coming alongside the first of the other craft parked up. This spaceship was a Class 3 destroyer. Similar in appearance to the Gunda, except with an old-style stabilized obsidiatoronium drive and 100 meters greater in length. The craft was so new its name was still visible on the side. SC Hoplite. The gravity car went by a second destroyer, this time with its name eroded by flight through grit and other atmospheric particles. The vehicle came to a halt.
"The Gunda," said Keller. She pushed open the door and climbed out. Nation got out of the opposite door and walked around to join her. He was a head taller, and guessed his augmentations made him 250 pounds heavier. They were on the same team, but their methods of achieving mission goals were radically different.
"One of the fastest and deadliest ships in the fleet," said Nation.
"It makes a good statement of intent. The Estral won't dare tell us to piss off unless they have plenty of backup."
The spaceship's front boarding ramp was lowered and a group of soldiers were standing guard at the bottom, accompanied by an evil-looking mobile repeater turret with deflective front shields and a dense, angular main body. The device's 9-barrel gun rotated slowly. Keller did her best to ignore it and she approached the group. A man in a plain, dark blue uniform approached with his rifle slung across his back and his sidearm within easy reach. He held a tablet in one hand and studied it as he walked.
"Lieutenants Keller and Nation," he snapped a salute. "I'm Corporal Hancock."
"The officer in charge?"
"That's right. The Gunda is happy to have you on board. It's a sweetheart."
"I'm sure it is, Corporal."
Hancock stepped aside and made an exaggerated flourish with one hand to indicate they could board whenever they wanted.
"Going somewhere special?"
"Very special," agreed Nation.
Hancock tried to hide his disappointment at being so easily rebuffed.
"Well then, have a nice trip."
"Thank you."
The soldiers, a full squad of 20, watched Keller and Nation go by. In truth, stealing a core warship wasn't straightforward. It simply wouldn't take off if you didn't have clearance. If anyone was somehow clever or stupid enough to sneak on board, they would discover an impressive array of automated miniguns concealed throughout the interior. The main airlock at the top of the boarding ramp was a plain, walled space, cramped and bathed in red. The exit passage cut through 10 meters of solid alloy and was protected by a pair of doors which vanished into ceiling recesses. Keller paused.
"Hello?"
"Hello, Lieutenant Keller," came the reply. There was perhaps more female than male to the tones.
"What's your name?"
"I am Teal. Welcome aboard." Keller led the way from the airlock. The Gunda was mostly engines, with a little extra taken up by weapons and life support. Far down the priority list came the human occupants, and the warship's internal corridors were narrow, freezing cold and claustrophobic. Ships like the Gunda weren't designed to carry passengers. The fleet had other vessel types dedicated to the task of moving large numbers of armed personnel. A retaliator was purely meant for offensive duties. In times of war, it could be equipped with a wide variety of weapons, some of which had the destructive power to annihilate a star. The cockpit was a tiny rectangular room, lit in a blue-white colour and with three front-facing seats. The front bulkhead was dominated by a huge display designed to look like a car windscreen. At the moment, it showed the area of the Fortress 3 base which was visible to the warship's front sensor array. Nation peered through. Keller sat in the middle seat, which was infinitely adjustable, covered in supple brown leather and surrounded by smaller screens and instrument panels. There was a complicated harness, which she ignored. In these days of sophisticated life support systems, if you needed to rely on something so basic as a harness for anything, it was likely you were already dead. There was a second door in the rear bulkhead wall and Nation checked it out. It led onto a tiny corridor, with a row of low, narrow doors. He yanked one of them open. Inside was a stark white room about 4 feet wide, 8 long, and furnished with a single bed, a view screen, and a tiny bedside table.
"No surprises here," he shouted. "Same as pretty much every other warship. 6 sleep pods, 1 replicator, and a place to take a crap."
"Great. We should get moving."
Nation ducked back through the doorway and got into the left-hand seat. "I'll let you handle the AI. Flying isn't my thing." Keller cleared her throat. It was a couple of years since she'd been on board a retaliator.
Teal, are we cleared to take off?
I thought you would never ask. We have priority clearance to depart, said the ship's AI. I have the details of your destination and my databanks are up to date with your mission priorities.
Is there anything new? Asked Nation.
There is a 972-page mission briefing file if you would care to take a look, Lieutenant. I can download it directly into your databanks if you wish.
I wouldn't bother, said Keller. I just read it. Nation was at that moment digesting the last few pages of the same document. It was crammed with cobbled-together pieces of speculation, guesswork, and 300 probability tables. The roundup pages may as well have been blank for all the insight they contained.
Full of crap, he muttered. No one has a damn clue. I have just received a query from a source with Admiral Cody's signature, said Teal. He wonders why I am still, and I quote, sitting on the goddamn landing strip.
Close up the ramp and send a message to Corporal Hancock telling him it's time to be on his way, said Keller, at the double.
I completed both of those tasks before you arrived on the bridge, Lieutenant.
An AI that takes pride in its work. Let's get on with this, said Nation.
Initiating takeoff routine, said Teal. Hold on to your hats.
The Gunder's Estolia drive came online with a grumbling roar from its detonators. The hull shook for a moment before the main engine settled into a smooth background whine. The ship's AI scanned the surrounding area, checked in for a final time with the Fortress 3 XR mainframe, and decided there was no risk of harming any nearby ground crew. The whining of the engine climbed steadily, and the SC Gunder took off. It rose vertically from its berth into the grey skies of Aerial. Through the front view screen, the two crew members watched the distant horizon. Far away on a huge, levelled area of ground to the north of Fortress 3, ancient spaceships were lined up in neat rows. Their scarred armour plates were unreflective, as though these proud, indomitable craft defied even the light of the sun.
There is the graveyard, said Keller.
320 decommissioned warships from 100 years ago. It gives me the shivers every time I go there. So many records and so much death.
I try not to think about it too hard. The Gunder's ascent was rapid and it soon entered the clouds. Mist colored the viewscreen, hiding the graveyard from sight.
Clear the screen, ordered Keller. I don't want any of this crap obscuring the view.
Instantly, the image sharpened and the warship's sensors pierced directly through the cloud cover, filtering them out as if they didn't exist. The graveyard was already lost below, and now they could see the cusp of Aerial as a line dividing the drab greens and blues from the pure blackness of space.
The beauty of the infinite, said Teal wistfully.
You're not one of those fruitcake AIs, are you? Asked Keller.
The word is unique, Lieutenant Keller.
I prefer nuts. The AI wasn't programmed to take offense, and it didn't respond. The SC Gunder climbed much faster now that it was outside the planet's atmosphere. The Estolia drive's whine was in perfect harmony with the rest of the ship.
6,000 clicks per second, said Keller,
and only using 0.0003% of our available power.
Target set, Primal 1. Arrival time, 18 minutes, said Teal. Activating lightspeed drive.
The SC Gunder rumbled again, and its engines took on a howling note, which gave hints at how much it had in reserve. The warship opened a passage into high light speed and raced towards its destination.
3.
The SC Gunder exited light speed, and the hum from its Estolia drive dropped away into the background.
Primal 1, announced Teal.
Under the terms of the Human Estral Peace Accord, no spaceship from either side was permitted to simply enter the territory of the other. All traffic was required to traverse one of the small number of wormholes which linked the two parts of the universe. The Estral didn't encourage trade, and therefore not many transits took place.
Nation glanced at one of the screens next to his chair.
200,000 clicks out. Bang on the nose.
I aim to please, Lieutenant, said Teal. The McKinney station acknowledges our presence, and the warships Eagle, Linster, Canyon, and Pincer say hello.
Return the greeting, said Keller. Ask them if the weather has been good. The four Class II invokes kept their stealth modules active,
though it didn't stop the Gunder's tactical screen identifying them and displaying their position. A warship on the Space Corps network was normally visible to any other on the same network. Only four. I guess there are more running silent, asked Nation out of curiosity. Keller gave him a nod. Undoubtedly. The main screen showed an image of the McKinney station. It was a vast, hulking construction of dark alloys, 6,000 meters in length and 2,000 in height and depth. The station was equipped with dozens of beam repeaters and an energy shield with enough power to repel an attack from 100 or more enemy spaceships. It was also rumored to be equipped with an Estolia bomb, which, if detonated, would destroy everything within 80 billion kilometers, including the wormhole. Keller wasn't meant to know, since the files were highly classified, but the rumors were true. "Show me Primal 1," she said. Instantly, the main screen switched to high zoom, focused straight on the wormhole. The portal itself wasn't much to look at, being nothing more than a circle of darkness a few hundred kilometers across. Without the ship's sensors to adjust the colors, Primal 1 would have been undistinguishable from the background. The wormhole wasn't a natural phenomenon. Arranged about it was a series of immense, dark gray spheres, each with a diameter of 2,000 meters. These spheres crackled and spat blue shards of energy into the vacuum. Power flowed from them into a torrent and, in tandem, they kept the wormhole from collapsing into nothingness. Given how few spaceships traveled through, it was a tremendous waste of resources, especially since a warship such as the SC Gunder could use its light-speed catapult to create its own temporary wormhole in order to cross vast distances in a short space of time. "Anything to report before I give the order?" asked Keller. "I am checking with McKinney Station," said Teal. "Apparently we're the first spaceship to go through since the SC Givens carrying the response team. Before that, you have to go back 5 weeks."
5 weeks?
Nation had enough clout to learn a few things when he wanted to, and he knew this was far longer than usual.
"Why so long?"
Keller didn't need to interrogate the Space Corps network to guess.
"Simmering tensions."
"Another degeneration towards war," spat Nation. "This visit is going to be fun."
"Handshakes and party hats," said Keller, repeating Admiral Cody's words from earlier. This was bad enough without additional complications.
Nation wasn't happy, and he tightened his fists, feeling the strength in his alloy fingers as they dug into his toughened flesh. Keller smiled.
"I thought covert ops lived for this."
"I prefer to arrive unexpected." The Gunder had clearance for the transit, and there was no reason for delay. "The sooner we get there, the sooner we find out." Keller itched to interface with the ship and throw it into the wormhole. It wasn't part of the mission, and she left it to Teal.
"Let's do this."
"I have informed the McKinney Station about our imminent departure. Energy shield online. Estolia drive warming up for a sublight run," said the AI.
The Gunder accelerated towards the wormhole and passed within a few hundred kilometers of the closest nullification sphere. Keller manually adjusted the sensor feed so they could see it clearly. The spheres were an excellent example of stolen alien tech put to more benign use by the Human Confederation. They housed such colossal reserves they were able to counter the crushing gravity of the wormhole. In theory, a soldier in a spacesuit could drift happily through without ill effects. Keller switched to the main front sensor array. Primal 1 came closer, until it filled the screen. The main indicator of its presence was the way it blocked out the stars from the background. The Gunder's acceleration stopped, leaving the warship traveling at a shade over 20,000 kilometers per second.
"Here we go."
Without fuss, the SC Gunder went through the wormhole. In a time too short for its sophisticated monitoring tools to register, it travelled a distance which would take a ship without a light-speed catapult 5 or more years to complete. There was no sensation of movement and no suggestion that anything monumental had occurred.
"We have arrived," announced Teal. "Shields remain active. The local star chart is populating."
On a screen to her right, Keller saw the warship's core clusters updating the tactical and navigational systems with details from the sensors.
"Where is our welcoming party?"
There were spaceships, but they didn't look especially welcoming.
"I am reading signs of 23 Estral ships in the vicinity, 9 of which are running stealth modules, said Teal. There are 8 target locks on our hull. As per Space Corps protocol, I am diverting power to our beam repeater and stasis emitters in preparation for retaliation.
There'll be no shooting, snapped Keller. Contact the Estral and instruct them to detarget. Message our base and let them know what we've found.
A comms message to base would take an hour to travel from out here, but it made sense to send a record of events.
Message sent. I am awaiting a response from the Estral.
Once more, Keller fought the urge to take control of the Gunda. The warship's battle computer wouldn't do anything stupid, she knew that.
A couple of new types amongst them, said Nation.
The local Estral fleet was from a mixture of large, older-style vessels, some of them between 2 and 3,000 meters long. These older craft were elaborately designed, with struts and beams protruding from their elongated hulls. They looked delicate and, in fact, they were somewhat less robust than an equivalent Space Corps model. The newer spaceships were far smaller and vaguely similar in design to the Gunda, though they were flatter and looked less cutting-edge. The Estral had only recently figured out how to refine obsidiateronium into pure Estolia, but they weren't meant to be using it on their spaceships. The existing peace treaty only permitted them to create limited quantities of Estolia and then only for civilian uses.
Plenty of beam weapons and plasma incendiaries, said Keller, reading through the raw sensor data. Missiles and lots of high explosives on the older ones.
Shield busters, asked Nation.
Of course.
The SC Gunda was equipped with a phase-changing shield. Any weapons which relied on phase shifting to bypass an energy shield, such as an overcharged particle beam or a shield.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.